but we are in debt to the next generation still because we haven't done much. I will be supporting him in any way possible, but we will try to work together on. I think I have to do something with this computer.
I welcome you too. Thank you for your participation.
And
now start the session. And
this is how my. Probably in the limited time that we have, it's only 2 hours, not getting into some meaningful results that we can follow up on as a network. So I would suggest that we refer to the key independent living notions. And I have just allowed myself to, I just allowed myself to put them for reminding, as a reminder for you. And these notions are self-determination, freedom of choice, and control over one's own life and lifestyle. I find these three notions as the most important for independent living, because out of them stem all the rest, like the need for personal assistance, the need for accessibility, the need of public acceptance, the need efforts to provide peer support or to have our dignity respected. Does anybody want to add something? Alexandra, do you need me to repeat for you?
No.
Okay, thank you. If anybody wants to get something repeated or more information, please do not hesitate to ask.
When we were trying to lobby and campaigning for that Norwegian legislation, my name is Tove Brandvik, I'm from Yuluba, and I'm board member of EMIL. And Norway just passed a new law upon personal assistance. And we tried to translate this to a framework and a wording that the politician could actually grasp and understand. Because there is a lot of nice words, but the words isn't enough to grasp the content of it. So we decided to run our entire campaign based on four words, only four. And we chose the word what, where, when, and who. Because I like to decide what my assistance is going to be. I need a different kind of assistance from Corinne, from Kapka. It's going to be different because I'm an individual. Where? I have to choose where I'm going to be. In my house or in my neighboring city or in other country, it's up to me to choose that. When? At what time during the day do I need assistance? Is it in the night, in the morning, evenings? And who? Who's going to assist me? No. To make sure that the person who's actually a part of my very private sphere of life is going to be someone that I am communicating well with, and is a part of me that I can accept and like. So we chose four words, because the concept of independent living is hijacked by a lot of people. So when people are saying empowerment, a lot of professionals are putting other words into the concept of independent living and empowerment. So that
I
is
think that Tosa put the finger in the wound by
yeah.
saying that.
Exactly. So the most important questions are these words, these four words. Where, what?
And who?
And who? And the purpose. Oh, okay, sorry.
Maybe I would like to add some things from the second notion, that is
freedom of choice. Okay.
I would add an informed choice.
Freedom of and for?
Informed.
Informed
choice. Okay. Yeah, you're right.
Because freedom of choice, often from one who can hear, it's a choice of the people. Maybe they are not well informed when it comes to independent living. So they are limited in some way from their choice based on their information, based on their.
Okay. But that's also a good point. The freedom of informed choice. But what if somebody doesn't want to be informed?
There's no choice.
Oh, right, so that's why probably we have, but yeah, I can agree with you that informed choice is a more engaging form of, a way to put it. Yeah, thank you very much. Informed choice sounds good. The purpose of our meeting today, and generally the purpose in you, in this advocacy process, because we are a human rights network, and our major activity, major purpose is to advocate for independent living in Europe. I would say that the purpose of this meeting and of EU, respectively, is to push decision makers not just to ask them to be politely, you know, demanding, but just to push decision makers to pass and to implement independent living-based disability policy. Not just any disability policy, but independent living-based. And the second purpose is the word that Topa used, to prevent hijacking our language in the process of generating counterproductive disability policies. Because as it was mentioned several times repeatedly, our language is used and misused in most of the cases to legitimize, to give legitimacy to the status quo policies. And as we used to say, it is about all in disabilities and disability policies, it's all about politics. So actually, if there is political will, if there is knowledge, but even if there is no knowledge, but political will, knowledge could be found and introduced, then things could be much better.
And it is usually that this language it is used by policy makers in their own way. And this is what we have to stop. Stop learning from to use in the wrong way our terminology. When you want to build up something, you have to build it up in a right way of speaking, in the right way of terminology. It is very important to understand, to be in communication with each other. And we have to understand exactly what we mean when we say personal assistant, when we say living in my home, when we say community-based services. When you say this word, especially this word, you say to further.
Yeah. So, do we agree? Do we understand? As Stelios was making the remark, do we understand in a unified way the purpose of our exercise? Do we agree on that? Good. So, if I put the second somehow boundary of our framework of reference, is what we understand by independent living-based disability policy. First thing we understand is that it is based on support, not on care. So we hate to see care as major activity in the legislation which aims at human rights of disabled people. And this is usually what happens. We intend and we very much prefer to see support, and we intend to change to the care to support, but not just the word, the action. I mean, this care is very passive, somebody taking care of you. Support is really encouraging. Support is a respectful activity, if provided properly, of course. A prevalence of independent living over traditional care by legislation, meaning that more support in independent living should be put in the legislation, not just talk. Inclusive education, accessibility of all public services, housing options, all these things which are really independent living legislation. And a lot of awareness raising campaigns run by independent living organizations to change public attitudes. So, if we agree with these three parameters or factors of independent living-based legislation, that would be our reference framework. Do we agree with that? In which reference framework we will have to decide what we advocate for? Catherine.
My name is Catherine from EDF. I have one question about, I totally understand and agree with what you say there. The terminology sometimes carers is used in well-meaning way by, for example, Marion Harkin, who was at your event in the Parliament, who's been there for many years. She runs, for example, in the Parliament, the Intergroup on Carers. And what she wants to do is to kind of give visibility and attention to people who are either providing support to older people or children with disabilities. And you often see in the language of policy talking about parents or families with disabilities. I'm wondering how to use a better terminology than this carers network. Like a supporters network, it sounds like a football team support. So I don't know how to, you know, when talking to policymakers, how to actually address the, because in employment policy as well, the EU will have a new roadmap on balancing work and family life. And we've been advocating for them to include people with disabilities. But it's also important to advocate for families or people with disabilities. But how to use the terminology, what terminology to actually use? That's it, maybe it's for another time, but it's a...
Do you want to respond to that, Tover?
Yeah. We spent quite a lot of time on that issue, topic, when we were working on the latest legislation, because we were trying to get it out for the healthcare service.
Yeah.
So we choose to use the word service provider.
Even for family members?
Even for family members, because they are supporting around. But it's a difficult topic. And in the Norwegian, we have a different word for it, and it's plain Norwegian. I don't know the English word, but it's when it's about the family.
Yeah.
They're talking about those families that have an additional support need.
Okay.
Instead of caregiving needs, support need, because they need support to do the task that the family has.
Okay.
Without it.
I think that if you say service provider in the European context, people would just assume you mean.
Yeah.
And that is the reason why we sometimes have to discuss the words, because in Norway, service providers in the Norwegian word of it is a very great word to use, but when they're using it in Denmark or in UK, it's turned out to be a totally hopeless word.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's you have to do some discussion.
Yeah, the context is very important. Well, I would suggest that carers should be left in place as they are, because we cannot get rid of carers in European context.
Yeah.
Yeah.
These are all service, all family members.
Yeah. Yeah.
But if we can think about limiting the carers terminology to the family members who take care of their parent, and that's it. And whenever it comes to service providers in European context, these should be supporters.
Yeah.
Because,
but not those who are with with EAB, European Association, whatever.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is that care is very something very and very legitimate within the family.
Yeah, but I think the terminology as well that you mentioned, families with extra support needs, that can also work in such context. That can work well. And the carers thing is, it is how it is.
But even if we keep the carers, I think that the support is the key word.
It's a better term.
Mm-hmm. But unfortunately,
our relatives could do something, but some of them help us to do it.
Yeah.
But with the word care is something paternalization.
Yeah.
And you know, it's if we go back to the key IL notions, self-determination and freedom of informed choice, would make disabled people themselves to decide whether to go for care or support if they are really informed, if they are empowered. So it's all linked together.
Yeah.
We can't get, and we don't want to get rid of the family thing because it's important.
Yeah.
What we want to see is, to find the path between care and support, and move with the aging of people from care, because, in a way, it's normal for parents to take care of their children. But they are also supporting their development.
Yeah.
Because every human being needs everything.
Yeah.
As well as people with disabilities. But support is a special and it's a different, it's totally different to others.
Okay.
Kapka.
Why make it so difficult by just not using the word assistance?
Yes.
We all need assistance.
Yes, I think we.
The manager needs assistance from his secretary.
Yes.
I need assistance from going to the toilet. Maybe somebody else needs assistance in making decisions, etc.
You need assistance for support or for care. So you need to choose to have the word support towards care. Because the word assistant can fit in both support and care. So we need the word assistant, go to the word support, goes to the word support. In my mind.
I think we are making it more complicated.
In the way you like.
Yes?
May I add something? It's just a bit strange to me because I think we had almost the same discussion in Germany to say, is it okay to say care or is it okay to say assistance? And we really fought for many, many years to get away from this word care, and now everybody said, or at least the people involved in our scene, they say, okay, the word is assistance. It's a rather unusual. unusual word in German to say this. But now we are at the point that everybody understood what is assistance, and now we should say support. So why not? What's the problem? Why not say assistance?
If I can relate to that, is assistance for me is it is also the activity part. The support word indicates the concept. That's my understanding and my idea behind using both support and assistance. I'm not against assistance, but the assistance is the activity which you expect to receive and be paid by the government in order to support you in your self-determination and control of your life. You know what I mean?
Yes, okay.
So this is the political part, the other is the action part.
I think it's rather difficult to bring it to other foreign languages.
I know,
that's
but
really,
and that's why we are trying to now to figure out how to make this work for EU as a network.
Yeah. It just happened a couple of months ago that I learned that the word participation means something completely different than most of the German people think participation means.
What do you mean?
Participation in German means to be with each other, to be together with someone. And
not to take part.
Not to take part. So it's a bit, it's really different to bring it to different levels.
Actually it's very difficult because we are in the union, we have so many cultural contexts.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And this we have the same problem.
So yes, I was happy with the word assistance.
I don't see any reason why we should leave this concept. Another dangerous concept that has been introduced is community-based services. Services here in continental Europe has the meaning of collectively organized.
Absolutely.
Assistance.
Yes.
So this term is promoted over the last years systematically. So how?
From institutional to community-based care. Catherine, do you know this?
Yes. Yeah,
it's a
yeah.
huge book.
Yeah.
Do you catch the title? Guidelines for Transition from Institutional to Community-Based Care. So actually what happens is, and how this can be understood, is from care in institutions to care in the community. And this is exactly what happens. I mean, literally. And if we were able to push for a title like Guidelines for Transition from Institutional Care to Community-Based Support, I would like to believe that we would have more chance to see community-based support and services. Well, it's my imagination, of course. It's my personal belief. I'm not sure that this would be the case. However, I'm just quoting it as an example. What do we mean by based on support versus care?
What I want to say is, when we were confused, there is someone assistance who support us, not take care of us. It's very simple to understand that, yes, these persons are assistants to support us.
Patrick, or excuse me, I failed to remember your name.
But maybe we will say the same. I
don't know. Sometimes we say the same. We go together.
Do you want Mike? My assistant will be so nice with us, and he will help us all too.
I don't know if I could add to thinking about these words, but maybe support has more ways than just assistance. I think the change from care to support is kind of change in the way we look at the position of a person with a disability and is receiving care. Oh, thank you. And support, he is the one who is organizing his support, like everybody needs support. But the support could be given in various ways, that not only personal assistance, but in other ways.
Housing,
also in schools by special education, special needs teachers. So this is more about the way of thinking, and that assistance is one of kind of supports we could need. More in a general term, support. Just adding this idea.
Okay. Any other questions? Yeah, and then Tova wants to add.
Yes, I want to say something different as Patrick.
Could you introduce yourself?
Yes, I'm Catherine, I work for HUIP, one of the member organizations in Belgium, of INO. I'm a colleague of Patrick. I understood we will talk about community-based services later on. For me, the concept of community-based support has the same question maybe in it. What is this community-based, based on the community? In Flanders, we see a big push to the families, also the regular services who are not controlled by the individual. They offer something and you have to take it or leave it. But they call it community-based service, I think. Maybe they would call it community-based support. So just also maybe think about this community-based, what is it? That was the only thing I wanted to stress. For me, the community-based services as the ideal is not so clear. What is it? And I think personal assistance, or assistance maybe, I don't know, is very clear. And I think it's just important that you keep on stressing these principles of personal assistance and so be aware to not go into another stream of terms.
Tell me what to read as well. And I, in the meantime, I found the definition of INIO related to community-based services, and we can also discuss before we move on to building our strategies to advocate. Go.
I'm really appreciating this debate because it shows that INIO has been around for a while, because Europe looked differently when we chose the word last time. And some of the worlds have different concepts in different countries. And we are going to face for the future, again, that we have to adapt different words, sometimes in different countries, to interlink with other laws in the country, to put it in a frame that is holding up national. But we have to find a way to actually translate that into a common language for the European Union. And that is the tricky part. Because as Corinne said, words in English, Germany and Norway has quite familiar or similar languages. They're,
but the context
the meaning
is
very different. So if I use it in Norway, the context of the word would be quite horrendous, actually. Because community-based services in Norway, if you're translating it directly to our language, we are fighting it every day.
So,
and that is a language part of it. So how are we going to solve it? We have to do that. That is a part of the youth network in the next generation.
Absolutely.
Because Europe has changed during the email term as well.
This is one of the purposes of the need to create a base
on the right terminology around Europe, to combine all these terminologies and to combine all these meanings of the different cultures of different countries, in order to be correct when we communicate.
Okay. So just to mark the issue of community-based services, which I hate as well because it's very controversial notion and concept as such. Because what happened in Bulgaria, for example, they moved large institutions from outskirts of the cities into the center, into downtown, and they decided that this is community-based. Because it's not going to be outskirts, you know. So, from this very primitive way of decoding or deciphering certain concepts to much more sophisticated manipulations. So it's critical. But therefore, INIO decided to work on INIO definition of community-based service, and it relates to defining that community-based services require both political and social approach. So this is very important to say. And policy measures for making all public services, like housing, education, transport, healthcare, all community public services, to be available and accessible to disabled people in mainstream settings. This is what we understand as INIO, as a network, by saying community-based services. And in order to make absolutely sure that this is what it should be, we say that community-based services eliminate the need for parallel services, like institutions, special schools, long-term hospitals, paratransit facilities, because the mainstream community services are accessible and available for disabled people. And in order to stress it even more, we say group homes are not independent living. Group homes are not community-based service.
I think that it's time to call this period is time to connect the community-based services with personal assistance.
Right.
It's the only of the land community-based service. Otherwise, it will go to small groups home. So it's time to rethink and to create a more concrete connection in our minds that the only community-based service is personal assistance and nothing else.
I slightly disagree, because we cannot live without transport. If we want to have people, disabled people educated, they need to go to mainstream schools. It's a service. Transport is a service. Personal assistance is not a service. Personal assistance is a right. At least in my understanding. And we can provide it on the basis of personal budget, on the basis of direct payment, on...
Okay.
But you're the manager. Do you consider it a service in Germany, personal assistance?
It's very... Yes, maybe the microphone.
Sure.
It's very special, I think. We have, in Germany, we have a so-called employer model, where a person with a disability is employer of her or his assistant. But that's rare.
Yeah, that's
so
rare.
There are not so many
But that's
people.
The right way to go.
That's, there are not so many people. But the wording, I really have a problem also with this community-based services. We also have these services.
What?
Community-based services. It's a difficult word for me too. I think it's maybe the same like in Norway. The people who run these services are the big organizations that used to run the institutions. And
This is not what we are talking about.
Yeah.
But you talk a different language.
Yes, that's the problem.
In continental Europe, we understand community-based services as collectively organized special services.
Oh, that's wrong.
Disabled.
Yeah, okay.
That's the meaning of the word over here.
But we are the ones who give the meaning to the word.
We should speak about inclusive transport, inclusive education, etc. That we will understand. But don't use the term community-based services.
I don't.
It will be, I'm sure it will be misused.
And that's exactly. And that's how we are trying to advocate, because this is not our term. This is the term.
PCCL systematically for years has.
Unfortunately, yes. But it was because of the push given by the Commission to have community-based services. And I agree with you totally. And because this term got already in, we somehow decided to put it in our glossary and give as much independent living meaning as possible. And otherwise, I agree with you. Mainstreaming and inclusion. Yeah, we will try. This is a point for advocacy to get rid of community-based services and move to inclusive transport, inclusive education, inclusive employment. Yeah, I agree with that. And if we are done, somebody wants to say something. I am convinced that you guys all have access to the definitions that in your proposals, and I think that a debate will be more than welcome on definitions as well, although they have been discussed for quite a while. And then we posted them on our website, we are trying to push down for the Commission and the European institutions to use them, to start applying them as maybe as a standard, because probably they will not be able, because of this different, of this, how do you call it, that EU doesn't have a mandate to this competence.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Because of the lack of competence of EU on national level, they will not be able to impose them on member states. But at least they can produce a sort of a standard, a golden standard or something that would be recommended to the member states. So I think this is one of a very important point on our agenda, to push the definitions for acceptance to the Commission and EU institutions as whatever golden standard or a rule, but I don't think a rule will be possible, in order to avoid a further misunderstanding and further wrong policies. But I would suggest that we also restart the discussion, our internal discussion, on the final wording or revision of the definitions as they are now. Because I do agree that community-based services isn't the best thing,
right,
in terms of terminology.
I would like to add, if we create something official, we can go against our national other disabled organization who uses the right way of our meanings in order to confuse the people and in order to make their own wrong decisions. Because when someone from Greece used the confused word community-based service, he can think that there are many things. But if we make an official agreement between any EU institutions, we can support our ideas, and we can support our way of thinking.
Thank you, Catherine.
So I was looking at the definitions beforehand, because it's also, of course, really interesting for EDF, and I don't know if you've ever made short videos or pictures, pictograms. I'm thinking that when ENL members are talking about independent living, you mean the same thing, but it's still, firstly, people don't really read a lot of text often these days. And another part of this is it could be, it's of course, the EU can totally do this under their remit to do awareness raising and promotion of fundamental rights. So they can't make member states, but maybe to educate other disability organizations and also to educate, ourselves, it could be a good process to see. But firstly, you know that a lot of people with intellectual disabilities are very much at risk of institutional living. Mm-hmm. And there as well, you need something which is very easy for people to understand and see, whether it's, you know, whether it's animated or whether it's short videos or whether, and also saying what it's not, because of this thing, it's not, you know, you can show a picture of an institution moving it into the center of town with a cross through, this is not community based. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, just to try and illustrate more.
That's a perfect idea. Yeah. One thing that probably we will never abandon as a concept is that independent living is for all disabled people.
Yeah.
No matter the level of support.
Yeah. Yeah.
So this is something that we are all positive, 100% positive about. Sure.
Yeah.
And Tobin, I'm sorry, Tobin. This is the next generation. They don't. Go.
In my organization, we are
advocacy organization in Romania, and we are people with physical and intellectual disabilities. In Romania, I don't know what how is in other countries, but in Romania, people with intellectual disabilities are more risking group not to understand their rights. They don't know their rights. So what we have done, it was to translate the CRPD in easy to understand language and to make a brochure. If we want to be independent and we agree that everyone has the right to be independent, we must be sure that everyone understands what independence means. It means okay to take decisions rather than bad or good decisions, but it's our right to take the decisions. And one other point that I wanted to say, I saw very often used this term, people with disabilities. Disabled people. To be honest, I don't like this term because...
Disabled people.
Because I think that we are people first. And yes, then we have a disability. But people should be first, in my opinion.
I'm
just thinking, to go for a new question. We made a lot of that kind of videos during the campaign in Norway, very effective, just to show what's the difference, and you got a minute to do it. Because if it's more than a minute, anybody's switching to the next channel or something. So yeah, we are going to take that away.
Just one other point on that is.
What do you want?
Oh, sorry.
It was. You were out of the.
We were out of the picture.
Yes.
We are not important.
Yes.
You guys are important.
Somebody from the Ministry of Social Welfare in Latvia was complaining to me. Because now they can't use any money anymore for institutions. They can't paint them, they can't fix the heaters, they can't do that. And I said, well, that was the point of the regulation. If you want to fix the heaters, you use your own money, you don't use European structural funds. That was the point of the regulation. When I talked a bit
more... So they put the money into small group homes.
No,
they will
they're
wind
actually,
away.
She was so frustrated by the regulation, which I thought was good news.
Absolutely.
The other thing was, when I discussed with her in more detail, she actually did not believe it was all at all possible for people with disabilities to live independently. So I think as well, you also can provide to government ministries some physical evidence of the fact that people with disabilities of any level of support need can live independently. Because some people, they just don't believe it because they've never seen it with their own eyes.
Hi, I am Fatma from Turkey, and I worked in an association for several years. It is called Human Rights and Mental Health Initiative, and the last point was our point also, and personally, I am a family member of people with mental disabilities, and in Turkish also we tried for a long time using the right words without labeling people, and this disabled people, one of them was this word. We also prefer to use people with mental disabilities or people with psychiatric label or people with labeled with schizophrenia, etc. But it is so difficult because, you know, they are not in the mainstream using, so people don't understand at first. Also, we tried with users, but it doesn't fit into Turkish service users, etc. But my 5 or 10 minutes ago, I was about to tell something about this support, this decision making in this mental health area, both for intellectual and psychosocial disabilities. The main thing is that they cannot decide for themselves. In the law, in Turkish law, it's still that. The main point is this. So all the legal people, all officials, take this as a main line, and they don't think about that, and it is the main obstacle, in fact. So in CRPD, the Article 12, this legal capacity is the main article. People are agenda is on that. But 3 years ago, we organized a symposium on this guardianship versus supportive decision making, and someone from Canada, I forgot the name, and from India, and also Gabor Gambos, maybe you know Gabor, from Hungary. They were our guest speakers. And I learned that in Canada, they totally abolished this guardianship, and they established supportive decision making. And in that meeting, there were very high qualified lawyers, and one of them was working on disability rights. And she said directly, really, it is very difficult for me to think about, to accept this. Someone very severe, mental disability or with severe intellectual disability can decide for himself or herself. It is impossible. And how we can protect them? Because this law, mainly this guardianship, based on protecting people's rights. But in real life, it turns it into opposite, you know, and taking their rights from words, this being a person, and etc. And this supportive decision making is very good term, I think, based on support, and the guardianship based on this care and protecting model. And this is an addition from myself.
Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, but this shows again how important it is to put the right meaning into the words and make sure that when people say guardianship, they know what it means, and supportive decision making, what it means.
Yes,
no. Well, unfortunately, we don't have in Bulgaria supportive decision making either. I don't think it's very popular in Europe. So it's these are the first steps here. Do you have supportive decision making in Germany? Sorry?
We know the word, but I don't know if there
is. Yeah.
But as far as I know, there is some applications in Germany and Austria.
It is called psychiatric pre-consent form or this advanced directives. There are, in fact, applications of this kind of supported decision making. For example, if a person has a schizophrenia and when he or she is in a stable mode, and he or she writes a letter. If I have under crisis, please do this, do
yeah,
this,
yeah, yeah,
please,
yeah,
etc. And this is a part of supportive decision making. And if a police or someone finds some person, first he or she has to look for such a letter and act accordingly. And it's a good way of it, I think.
Yeah. Thank you. I think you wanted to say something. Next to Patrick.
No.
Are you sure? Okay. So I think it was a very interesting point made on the basis of Turkish experience, however, very much relevant to the rest of Europe, and certainly relevant to the European Union, because there are many countries where guardianship is overwhelming in terms of intellectual disabilities and mental health problems. And I'm sure that it's a part of the independent living approach to advocate for supported decision making and peer support. And something that I want to somehow wrap up the whole thing that we are fighting for is that personal assistance is a must when we are talking independent living. and it's a must. It has to be portable between countries, regions, and cities. It should go with peer support, and it should be based on individual needs with no income test. Because one of the issues that, for example, people face in UK is that there is income test, and it's personal assistance, well, like actually direct payments users are supposed to contribute to their assistance depending on the income which they have. And if we consider personal assistance as independent living as a human right and personal assistance as a must for independent living, then income test or how do you call it?
Means
testing is totally irrelevant. So we have to take it away. Now you wanted to say something.
I wanted to say something, yes.
I managed to promote you. Thank you.
First of all, I wanted to say something that I learned something talking to many people here during the last days, and maybe that's an issue for Daniel too. I was surprised that in many countries, everything that has to do with personal assistance and legislation on personal assistance is a regional matter, like in France, like in Belgium.
Is what?
It's a regional matter, or maybe.
Yes, a regional matter.
For cities,
right.
For communities. And for me, that's maybe an issue. Living apart, the transport. The transportability of personal assistance over Europe, even within countries, it's a major issue for the freedom of residents. Maybe that's one issue to further address in the future. I think one should be very careful about that.
I know that in Germany it's also on regional basis, isn't it?
Yes.
Yes. And especially in Germany, it's the most complicated system in the world.
Yeah.
I think you have like 7 institutions involved in your personal assistance, aren't you?
Mm-hmm.
Don't you? Like you have the insurance thing, you have social security thing, you have something else. Gosh, I'm too stupid to
know.
Maybe
it's the same.
Is it the same? Okay.
But this interest system.
You don't have much. that's the case of Bulgaria. Very simple way. No personal assistance at all. Yeah, you want more?
I have one more question, actually. I'm sorry.
I would allow 2 more, and I want to move quickly to the next issue, which is important.
Another issue that I'm very glad to read on the screen, that it has to be based on individual needs. It's just mentioned that the new decree that on this matter, a part of it provides support systems which is not based on individual needs. It's far too complicated to explain now in a few words. That's one thing. But another, but I see even in federal law, in federal social security law, we have also benefits that are not based directly on individual needs.
Yeah.
What I see and what I experience in daily life, a lot of DPOs are not really opposed to this kind of legislation. They say that there needs to be a link, but not a direct link with individual needs.
Yeah. And it's easier.
It's easier
to go on, you know, on group by group basis instead of individual basis.
There's no more
I've been thinking about this terminology, this care, support, and personal assistance, and I think it is important to not the personal system not to be hijacked or get in the crowd with other terminology, because personal assistance is directly linked to the independence and individual's freedom.
That's true.
So if somehow we let this slip and support and care comes next to it, that's government is going to straight away say, this is the system, we're going to care for you, and we're going to provide, we're going to systemize this, and so on and so forth. So it is very important to keep the personal assistance strong and underlined, because it's individual based, whatever the individuals need. So I think it's important, as Enel is, you know, stressing all this terminology.
Thank you very much. It's a very good point. We need to be very careful about that. But I think that we have great benefits with Catherine being in our group. Because I don't know, guys, how far you know, how far you're aware and have information about this upcoming European Disability Card. Which was, by the way, mentioned today morning in the short expose of Richard, I
yes.
think Richard mentioned it, the MEP from UK, Richard Howard. I had a chance, actually, Stelios was the one who enlightened me about the European Disability Card with a lot of concern, and his concern is very legitimate. For me, there is one. And not only, but there is one major reason for that. There is a call for proposals which has been distributed by the Commission, and proposals are expected to come from A, government organizations, or NGOs, DPOs, which are recognized by the government. Am I correct?
I can give a total summary of the thing.
I would be, I will, because this is the moment and this is the point which will require most of our advocacy efforts, I think.
Okay,
or,
the thing is,
correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, the reason why you're wrong is because the disability card is actually not very significant. What it does, it's a pilot project with no legal basis. It's got no sustainable funding. It's a once-off call for proposals. It's a pilot initiative which governments can volunteer to be part of. There was 19 governments which took part in this project working group. They discussed what would be the benefits of the card, what the card would cover and everything. What they end up with is the concept for the card is that it covers. So if you have this card, and you travel with this card from Ireland, for example, to go on holidays to England, with this card, you would have the same benefits as a person with a disability in museums, sports clubs, cultural events, things like this, so, and mostly to transport. So what it would do is it would allow you, without having to give a big explanation or a big talk, to receive a reduction to the cinema or a reduction. On an equal basis, it will not enable you to have sign translation, because that, of course, would be in the local language. It's, for me, it's like it could be the beginning of something which could be like portability of benefits or services. But at the moment, it's extremely far away from that, and it's not conceived by the Commission and the Member States at all as giving you anything apart from a sort of a recognition. It's quite a symbolic thing. And then, so on the call for proposals, they issued it in July with a deadline at the end of September. Some countries found the deadline too short. It's true that it's only a public authority who can apply, or if a public authority nominates somebody else. So I know in Finland, the public authority are nominating an organization, like some NGO, but I don't know them. I remember hearing that they had nominated. So in some countries, it may be that a DPO is nominated to manage the card, like in Denmark, it's the Danish organization who actually issue parking cards. So I'm not so familiar with the whole parking card thing, but to be honest, the process, it's got this funding this year, but I don't know if it will go any further, because they say there won't be any more funding afterwards. And many of the countries say that they won't apply because they have no legal basis for this in their country. Some countries don't have any disability recognition, others do, and it clashes with them. So that's a little bit of a summary of where it is. The deadline is the end of September.
This budget is
about
1.3 million
or something?
This budget is about to save the idea of EU disability guide.
It's a pilot to
exactly.
Help people initiate the process.
Exactly. But
to start printing cards.
But I think, as you said, it's a great five final word for what an EU disability guide means. Because to create a strong idea about this tool, we have to create a common law legislation around Europe about people with disabilities.
Another issue is that, of course, the biggest barrier for if any of you want this evening to go to a local sports club, the biggest barrier will not be the lack of a card. It'll
absolutely
be the fact that the sports club is not accessible.
Yes.
Yeah. The card won't change
yes.
that. It'll only make it more embarrassing for the public services, maybe.
Okay, portability is an interesting discussion point. But the main worry for us is to get personal assistance.
Yeah.
And what we should do in EU is to reinforce each other, each one in this country, because don't dream about European legislation. Europe is not has not a competence in the matter of welfare and assistance. What we should do in EU is to support each other in his or her country to fight for real good personal assistance schemes. And portability is, for me, it's a luxury discussion.
Mm-hmm.
Because most of us in Europe, we don't even have these personal assistance schemes. So let's support each other to fight for it first.
You are from Belgium, aren't you? So you do have assistance.
Let me go back.
Some people have assistance, but there are a lot of people on the waiting list for assistance.
Yeah, I know.
Kapka,
I'm on the waiting list. Yeah.
When I
yeah.
first saw you here arriving, you said you were straightforward and you have a lot of buts. So you accepted me to be straightforward now.
Absolutely.
Okay. I have
with
a request.
Buts.
I have no buts. I have a request. We started the workshop about become more effective in advocating
yeah.
for legislation which promotes independent living. We still have half an hour. Could we have it about that? But we did a frame, but we lost in the languages.
The Spanish.
So far, I can say that we we decided to revise the IR definitions and start the discussion between us. Then, of course, promote the definitions on EU level and look for a way to make them a sort of a standard which is accepted by European institutions and whatever they can do. And here comes the last question. In my understanding, perhaps I'm wrong, this is the institutional framework of NGOs that we can somehow use as our allies or make allies in our advocating for independent living. And probably again, it's very good that Catherine is with us. For those who don't know, Catherine is the executive director of European Disability Forum for the last.
Since January
this year. So, I would very much appreciate your thoughts on this institutional framework that we can fit our advocacy efforts.
What did you do about
to be out of genders in your country? What did you do?
Belgium,
Germany, what Turkish? What did you do to be an advocator?
Okay, thank you. So, first I want to add one thing, because you, Kapka, often use the word that we need some standards.
No, I don't say that.
Yes, but something like standards we should write down.
For the commission.
For the commission, yes. I think it's dangerous to talk about standards. I prefer the word best practice or something.
Okay,
like that.
Good idea.
Okay.
But I would like to see it more. Yeah, I like the best practice, but I think about something more, maybe not obligatory, but more persistent for the government. You know what I mean? So that the government would be maybe not obliged, because the commission cannot oblige or put obligation on the government to do certain things in these areas, but at least to have a reference for allowed practices.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, Patrick.
I'm sorry. Yes, but I think the problem is for the countries that are a little bit more developed, a standard could mean that they have to step back.
That's why
I think a best practice. Maybe we would need something like a benchmarking at this
and
describe how it works in the different countries.
Yeah,
and then
great.
We should find out what's the best practice. We don't need to choose one certain country, but just have a look at the different measures they have in different countries and then find out what's the best practice and describe this and set it as a goal for the European institutions to reach.
You know, I remember a couple of years ago there was, it was very, very much the fashion of using open method of coordination. Do you remember that, these times, Catherine?
Yeah.
That, Patrick probably remembers. And maybe everybody else who had anything to do with policy research and monitoring and variation and stuff like that. This open method of coordination, OMC, was a terrible thing. It was blah, blah, blah. And every lousy practice could have been put into OMC terms as a brilliant thing. Because it's blah, blah. You know, there was no, I forget the word standard. What I mean is more of recommendation, which would be more than recommended, if you know what I mean. I know it's weird, but yeah, we need to think about it more carefully. Yeah, Patrick, what did you say?
I'm always going. There's a big question about these principles. In every country, there are differences. And
yeah.
I do not know if it's good to say, oh, I know, I can't be wrong, but I know in some Nordic countries, you don't have the possibility of engaging someone for yourself, and most of the people do it with these corporations. Is this a good thing or nothing? I don't think it would work, corporations in Flanders, so I stick to the idea it's better to be the best possible thing in Flanders if that would. So there's a level of principles, but in every country there's another context. Then after the first question, you asked me how did we do it in Flanders, that I cannot answer how it started. Joost was there at the start. I think in the start you made a group of people like he did, and then you went for a law. And then they got the law. But then the problem, and I had it in the parliament yesterday, there's a backslash yes, we have personal assistance, but there's a lot of people on the waiting list. And I think the problem is with these rights, they're not only for pioneers who can use the law, but they are for all. And when we say they are for all, this means the whole system has to change. And not only a couple of persons, the first ones, and the first 100 or 200,000, but all the 60,000 people who receive care, have to receive support, and that's for all. And then you get the opposition, and in your first slide, it was very important, first we have to get our rights, and then we have to be aware of them taking them back. That's what's happening in Flanders, taking them back. The power is in the institutions, and they use community-based service as the new thing, but they are at the power. So maybe you just could add some words about that, because I'm new, just only 10 years ago here.
Yeah, that's the interesting thing of an organization like Eden. We all have to fight in our own country with specific institutions and legislations and so on.
Yeah.
Yeah. But we have common goals, and we can learn a lot of the other ones. We did especially use from Sweden. I'm very interested in the new legislation in Norway. Not everything will be transposable, but we can use some achievements over there. It's a very important issue. If we can refer to other examples, without steel experiment in Sweden, I don't think it will, maybe it would have cost, but we need some point to refer to in order to support our own struggle beach in this country. Yeah. So this exchange of experience and this working on the common standards that we understand as people with disabilities themselves who have the experience of how we can manage to live independently, it means with the same range of choices as non-disabled people. If we can exchange the experience and we have a good form on that, I think it's more important even than working on the strict European level with the European Commission, etc., because finally the competence in social matters is not in Europe.
In Europe, absolutely.
Of course, they can help with anti-discrimination guidelines, etc., to obtain more accessibility on trains and even other transport means. They can be very useful. But Our main concern is to live independently, and therefore we need to have the control over the assistance we need. This is still the main objective, the main issue. Not if we have a European part, so that we can have a half euro less to pay at the theater in Paris. And we go to London.
It's
okay, that's interesting.
No, it's ridiculous.
That's not essential. These are luxury problems.
Yeah.
How can he have control over all our life, even if we are really dependent on assistance, even for 24 hours, whether it is we need somebody to translate for us, whether it is somebody who helps us physically, whether it is somebody who supports our decisions, whether we need 10 hours a day or 24 hours a day, or even if we need two assistants at the same time, we have the right to live and to control this assistance so that we can live on with the same range of choices and self-determination as people who don't have a disability. And how we can reach this, each will have to do it in his country. We can learn a lot of each other.
Just a minute, I have an additional question. What should be the advocacy after the legislation? Because we have the legislation, and so what? We have to push again to implement.
In fact, the legislation passed in, just was it 2000 or 2001?
2000.
The first legislation was about personal assistance budget, and then there was a second legislation, PGB, with meaning all kinds of support, even in institutions, should pass via direct payment or voucher. So this law passed, but it wasn't implemented. And then this is where I see that other systems interfered of providing the law to be implemented. And eventually, they put away the law, they put away the PAB law, and they put away the second law, and they made a new law, a law with more at hand of big organizations. That's my point of view. Others have another point of view, of course. So it's difficult when you have a law to get it implemented and not to be this law passed away again by another law.
I would like to go back to a discussion I had with you, Kapka, yesterday evening. And in order to get good advocates for independent living, as I see it from my perspective, I think we also need to work on further strengthening and form DPO organizations on the real meaning of independent living and what it stands for. Because I see that too often, in my opinion, advocates for independent living are being described as progressive, as phenomena, among other phenomena. It's not really rooted in the DNA of all CPO organizations, at least as I see it now in France.
I just wanted to add two things about Belgium. I was not there, I just was there, but I think maybe one tool or one thing that can help is considering going to court In Belgium, there was an interesting case from a person who said, I can get a place in an institution, but I don't want to go to the institution. I want to stay and live in my house. Why can't I get the money government would give to the institution for myself, and I will organize the support to try to break in to this system?
That's just one of the means, huh? To win the war, you need all means, propaganda.
You need to convince academics, and you need academic reports to convince the public. You need the press, etc., etc. But the main thing is, we disabled people ourselves, we have to be sure of our case and to convince ourselves that we don't accept that because we are dependent on assistance, others will decide for us when we should get up in the morning, which schools we should attend, which people we should live with, etc. No. It's not because we are asking for assistance that we don't have any more the right to decide about our own life. We will never accept this. And we are sure of this objective, so we look together how we can obtain these objectives. And one of the means is indeed going to court and say, it's a human right for us to have the money to work so that we are able to organize ourselves, our assistance. But the main struggle is in fact a political one.
Absolutely.
And finally, we have to convince, we're living in a democracy, so finally it's the political parties and the parliament who have voted the first decree on personal assistance budget in 2000. And going to court was more a pressure mean to push the legislator to act.
I have a point to make. Well, if we are talking about our advocacy as a network, this means to me, as you said, support to our independent living advocates in different countries, but also a possibility to advocate on European level. Despite the fact that personal assistance is not within the competences of EU institutions. But at the same time, I think you made a brilliant point about organizations that DPLs, which somehow claim representation of disabled people, and surprisingly, they are against the personal assistance as a tool in disability policy. Mm-hmm. Do you have this experience, guys,
sure,
in other countries?
Sure.
Yeah, and that's
a lot of people with disabilities themselves don't really catch
the point of personal assistance. Yeah.
For instance, we didn't have in the beginning, we didn't have any cooperation from the deaf. They say,
from
the deaf people, bad hearing.
Deaf people.
They said, but we are not like you, we don't need assistance, we need interpreters. Yeah.
So,
yeah.
We told them, what's the difference? We need somebody to put our shoes on, and we need somebody to translate into your language. That's also assistance. Service providers always make a lot of mist and make confusion on so-called personalized services. They say we will transform into social enterprises. We are not longer institutions. No, we come to serve you individually. We give individually tailored support. We come at your home. But it has nothing to do with personal assistance. You cannot decide who is coming, what he or she would do, etc., etc. So you constantly you have to fight against this volunteer misinterpretations. And we need peer support, we need each other to maintain our belief and to go back to our roots and to really understand what is essential.
Thank you, Alexander. Tova and then Fatma, because Tova wanted a while ago. Go ahead, then Alex. Yeah, there you are.
I would like to raise this phenomenon, this problem that I am facing every day in Slovenia about not understanding the purpose of assistance or support or personal assistance. It's between blind people, we have serious problems because blind people do not seem to understand what assistance is all about, and they refuse very much to use service of personal assistance. And it's gone so far that they've also, on political level, they denied the need of personal assistance, and there are only three or four people in the country, together with me, who are blind, who are fighting for personal assistance. And I also have to say that in the organization that offers personal assistance to us, and I was also a user of personal assistance for a long time there, for some time, but I gave up on it because there were a lot of people, physically disabled people, on the waiting list, and I kind of decided that maybe they need assistance, really they need assistance more than I do, so I kind of gave my place to someone else. But we really have to make people understand, I think, in my opinion, what assistance is about and what it actually means to be independent, because there are still, maybe it's a step back. Right now we are speaking about more advanced things at the moment, but there are a lot of people in Europe who I don't think they really have the idea about the purpose and the meaning of independency and assistance.
Yeah. Okay, Tove, thank you very much, Alex. You say you don't need to be a lawyer to say what you said, which is the very point.
I'm going to try to be short, but we had some lesson learned in Norway from the first rounds, where a lot of other disabled or organizations for disabled was counterproductive, to put it mildly, in the process. So in the last round, we have the legislation built up in three rounds. We've been in there for a while. We had a meeting with all the other organizations, put together a group who was going to write on behalf of all the organization everything. So there were one message to the politicians, because it is a majority vote that we are needing. That means that we can't campaign with 9 different campaigns. They are not getting confused and say, oh no, I don't care. And then we took a round with politicians, with each group of the in the parliament, and had a training session with all of them. And then I came back to the four words. To get the concept of independent living, it can sometimes take a while for people. But if they at least can remember four words, it was possible to say, okay, that doesn't sound too bad. Sometimes I didn't understand the concept of that, but it doesn't matter because now it's in the law. So some of them are tricked into saying yes, but I don't care. So make an alliance and knowing where to target the goals and make it easy, so it's easy to understand and one message. That's the way.
But you guys have a one mature democracy. We,
yes.
Especially in the eastern parts of Europe, our new democracies were slightly different.
Yeah, but okay, it's not really an excuse.
No.
When we in Flanders, we fighted for rights of disabled people, and we referred to Holland, for instance, who was in advance. They said, yeah, in Holland they found gas under the ground. And we don't have so much money, etc., etc. So I think the message is pretty clear. Four powerful words who contain the essence of the message. And don't make complicated discussions. Different associations for disabled people try to bring them together after a clear message and make it true on the political scene. And if needed, you can use judicial proceedings, you can use the universities, you use the press, you go on television, etc., etc. But finally, you get your thing in the parliament, even in Bulgaria.
Well,
I think.
We are not giving up. But
yeah, in 2 minutes, I have a
just one, please.
One?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm sorry, but we are.
Okay. I think the real application of CRPD, because Turkey ratified it in 1.5 years later, but implementation is a problem. Our advocacy must stress the CRPD can be possible only with personal assistance, no more institutions. And this must be a good point, maybe. And also active participation of users in all levels of service provided. We were using this as a slogan in planning, implementation, and monitoring of all services. The users or the people with disabilities must be a part of these processes. Somehow, they are really, our officials know about this, but they don't apply this. But our advocacy also must contain this item, in all levels, not only in parliament, in the local levels,
yeah.
And in also for all kind of grassroots organizations, because they are take over that responsibility to officials most of the time. Our role must be say that no, it is our responsibility, it is your responsibility. And supporting individuals who want to live outside of institutions and make their voice and struggle visible in media. It must be maybe the other way of having their self-advocacy is another possible way. That's it.
Thank you very much. Catherine, are there any I would say, maybe ideas with an ETF to go more as an organization in support of personal assistance in Europe. Not like legislation, but as a policy recommendation or policy, whatever.
Yeah, I have a few thoughts summarizing some of the things, you know, on the session about being effective and yeah, working together on that. So one thing is I totally agree with the idea that we can't expect huge amounts of social policy to come from the EU. But they are implementing huge amounts of funding, and that's what you focused on, that's been very effective, and that has to continue. All the money they spend needs to support independent living, needs to be support inclusion, accessibility for people with disabilities. So that's important. The other thing is that while the EU itself is less important, the amount of importance that EU member states give to comparisons with other EU member states is a possibility that you could capitalize on. So for example, I agree with the idea that we won't get standards on independent living. Many governments, certainly Germany, are very resistant to like standards on something like this. What you could, a thought I had as you were discussing is, you could, like, it would take a while to do, but you could compare European member states on the basis of your definition of independent living, and not, the definition would have to be operationalized into questions, like you could have 10 questions. In Norway, in Belgium, in Croatia, can a person choose who provides assistance? Is there a law which actually, is there a law defining a right to independent living or personal assistance? Is there a budget applied? Who controls the budget? You know, these kind of things.
No, but so, you must be very careful.
No, I know, yeah. but you would have to choose yourselves. What are the...
Because they say, yeah, you can choose. We have a lot of different...
No, but they wouldn't say. Who will say?
No, you. I'm talking about what you could do.
Yeah.
You could make...
Our
initiative. So,
even if you put around the question to people with disabilities themselves, if you have a question like, can you choose who is providing you assistance? People will say, yeah, I can choose. I have three
different nursing services, and one of the Catholics, one of the socialists, and one of the nationalists.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So they fill out, I can choose.
Yeah.
So be very careful with that kind of
questionnaire. I'm not suggesting a questionnaire. I'm suggesting that you develop a benchmark as Ina, and you judge the system.
Yeah. Yeah.
You decide your criteria. You know you don't want the same thing in every country, but there's key principles of autonomy and self-determination. And you judge the system like a scorecard. You don't give the questionnaire to government or anyone else, but you judge according to us. You know, does it meet these criteria? It would take a while to do this. You have 2017, it's the 20th anniversary of EDF, but it's also the 10-year anniversary of the CRPD.
Yeah.
You could build up, yeah, so for example, if you show Romania don't care if they're not as good as Netherlands, but they would look at the other countries around them that they peer against, and they would not like to look too bad according to their, you know, geographical area. So if you make a map of Europe and you have red flags on certain things, you'd have to ask something on legal capacity, because as somebody said this morning, you can't, before you have your own house, before you sign a contract and decide to have to, you need to be able to sign a contract. So I think there's European action in comparison and benchmarking could be very, it could be